It's 10 hours.
Hallelujah. Praise be the name of our Lord. Brethren, it's 10 a.m. and I said we are going to do some prayers this morning. And the God be the glory for the gift of another brand new day. Also sleep and wake up and come into this brand new day. So we give him thanks. We give him all the glory. We give him all adoration for what he has done and for what he is going to do in our lives today. Praise the name of our God. So I mentioned that we are going to pray today. Glory be to God. But as I was preparing, God just changed the topic of what we are going to say, what I'm going to do. So the Holy Spirit took over and gave me what we are going to be discussing this morning. And we're going to pray this morning. So invite people, share this video. Let it get to people that need to see it. So we are about to start now. Hallelujah. Let's begin with worship. You are Yahweh. 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 Alpha and Omega. You are Yahweh, Alpha and Omega. You are Yahweh, you are Yahweh, you are Yahweh. You are Yahweh, you are Yahweh, Jesus, Jesus, you are Yahweh, oh. Alpha and Omega, oh Lord, you are Yahweh, Alpha and Omega. Glory be to God in the highest, amen. Glory be to God in the highest, amen. For his mercies endured forever, amen. For his mercies endured forever, amen. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Good morning, my brother. Good morning, my beautiful brothers in Africa. Dan, okay, thank you so much for coming. My own brother, Oroko Misere, welcome. Thanks for watching. So we're about to start now. And I want you to be in the spirit because I'm not sure what God is going to do today. But God is going to do something because God changed what I was going to pray about. And God just gave me something very different. Stay with me. Grab a cup of tea, whatever. Just stay. Let's see what God is going to do. Because it's not by my power. It's by the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. So today we are going to be looking at knowing your God. Knowing your God. So I was preparing to come here and pray for marriages. And as I was preparing to pray, and the Holy Spirit just said, do they know their God? And God said, go and speak on knowing your God. And that's what I'm going to be speaking about today. Knowing your God. Knowing your God, your creator. A lot of time people say, I'm a child of God. I'm born again Christian. Tongue speaking. In fact, sometimes they say, I'm a pastor. I pay tithe. I pay offering. But do you know your God? Do they know their God? That's the question. God say, do you know your God? And as I was writing, preparing the message, the Holy Spirit was telling me, I'm going to read them as I wrote it. We are going to be reading. Before I do that, I am going to be reading our scriptures today. I want you to open to with me to 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18. 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18. He says, "But grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. Amen." Grow in the grace and the knowledge of our Lord, Savior Jesus Christ. To him be the glory both now and forever. So God wants us to grow in his knowledge. So when God says knowing God, knowing your God, what is knowing your God? And what is not knowing God? What is not knowing God? Knowing God is not about dressing, looking, haggard, and dainty. Knowing God is not about somebody putting their clothes up to here and covering their head and don't wear earrings, don't do makeup. Because the Bible says that cleanliness is next to godliness. If you're going to preach the gospel for someone to give their life to Christ, they need to see you as an example of Christ. Because the Bible said that Jesus was made poor for you to be rich. Knowing God is not by wearing long skirts that cover everywhere. Although God said we should, as a child of God, we should dress modestly. Putting, tying turban and wearing all those clothes and doing everything. But inside of you, you don't know God. Inside of you, you are evil. Inside of you, you have hatred for your neighbor. Inside of you, you are evil. You are demonic. You're going to church. You are pressuring people in church. You're using your evil powers against your neighbor. You are raping innocent children. And then at the end of the day, you're a man. You wear what a cake suit. And say, you know God? The God just said to me again, knowing God is not by going to church. Knowing God is not by going to church. You can be in church for as long as you want to be in church, but if you don't have that personal relationship with God, you are wasting your time. Knowing God is not by going to church. No. Knowing God is not by being a worker in church. Knowing God is not by wearing the badge on your on the collar on your neck and say, I'm a pastor. Knowing God is not by title. I don't have a title, but my title I have is from God Almighty, to serve him. But people have been using the title that they are pastors. They do all sort of things to people. They rob them of their money. They put them in abject poverty, and they are making themselves rich. They don't know the God they profess. Because if you know the God you profess, as a pastor you call yourself, you should know that your congregation should be fed spiritually, physically, and everything. You cannot be a pastor, stand up out there with your collar, with your posh suit, and your posh shoe, and your posh bags, and your securities standing by your side, and then your congregation, you're preaching to them, they are dying in hunger, poverty, stricken people watching you. Knowing God is not by a title that you are a pastor, you're evangelist, but it's much more than that. I'm going to talk about that. When your heart is not right with God and you're using the collar to cover your iniquity to rob people, that is not knowing God. No. Knowing God is not by paying tithes and offering. A lot of people will go to church, they go and give big tithes to the pastor, and they bless them, and say, God bless you, my son. Who told you he's the son of God? It could even be the son of the devil that has robbed innocent people on the way of their hard-earning money. I've killed so many people and shed their blood on the way and robbed them of their properties, and they bring them and give in the church. They give a big tithe and a big offering. Pastor, you don't ask question, where is this money coming from? No, you bless them. Blessing them on earth doesn't mean they are blessed in the eyes of the Lord. Therefore, knowing God is not in paying tithe and offering. No. You cannot bribe God, and nobody can bribe eternal life. You cannot bribe the kingdom of God. No. You cannot bribe death even. because you may continue to play church and be stealing money and paying heavy tithes and be climbing in position and be promoted all the time. You're promoted in church. Your role is going higher and higher, but you know right inside of you, you are not right with God. You cannot bribe God with tithes and offering. If you like pay billions of pounds or dollars in tithes and offering, if you don't know your God, your creator, you are wasting your time. Those things you are giving can never pass the earth. So today, I pray that someone will come back to know their God, their creator. Also say here, knowing God is not by telling people about God. Knowing God is not by you going to evangelize. So, knowing God is not evangelism. If you go and be telling people about Christ and you don't know Christ, you are wasting your time. You know what you're doing? You're working like a conductor. You are bringing people into the car or into the bus. You're filling them up. Well done for bringing people to the kingdom of God. But what will happen to you that you're not born again? What will happen to you that your mind is not renewed every day? What will happen to you that you don't know the God that you are serving? You go to hell. And other people will go to heaven. Knowing God knowing God is not by title. Knowing God is not about what people say about you. You may deceive people, dress up, and try to behave anyhow. It's not even feeding the poor. You can go on the street and start to spread your money to the poor people. Give them, feed them, do everything. You don't still know God. And that does not still take you to heaven. Because the thing that we need to worry about is, where will I spend eternity? The Bible says in Hebrews chapter 9 verse 27 that it is appointed unto a man once to die, and after that comes judgment. Where will I spend eternity? And I and my household, we have determined to spend eternity in heaven. What about you? Where will you spend your eternity? Is it about paying tithes and offering and giving alms? No. That cannot take you to heaven. That cannot save your soul. The only thing that can save your soul is for you to receive Jesus Christ into your life as your Lord and personal Savior. The Holy Spirit is just telling me that a lot of people have received Jesus into their life. They made that decision once in a while in their lifetime. But they were carried away by the winds of this world. And yet, you are carried away by the winds of this world. But there's grace in the house. That's why I'm saying here, knowing God, let's see what knowing God is. Knowing God is having a personal understanding of your God. Having that knowledge, having the wisdom about God, having that true relationship with Him that you cannot be driven away by false doctrine. That's about knowing God. Knowing God is having personal understanding about God. That our God is not a wicked God. That our God is a God of mercy. He's a God of grace. He's a God of favor. He's a God of blessings. He's a God of a second chance. That's what knowing God is about. Knowing God is when you fall down. When you fall into sin, you don't run away from God. Knowing God is when you fall away from sin, you go back to Him and say, Father, I have messed up. I put your name to shame. I've fallen into sin. Jesus, have mercy on me. You cry unto Him like blind Bartimaeus did. Bartimaeus cried and said, Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me, because he knew who Jesus was. Even though he was blind, he didn't need an eye to see Him. But he knew who he was from the good news he heard about him. How many times have you heard about good news from Jesus? You heard about the good news from Jesus. You heard about the calling from Jesus. You heard about the salvation from Jesus. You heard about the death and resurrection of Jesus. But you choose to die in guilt. Why do you have to die in guilt? Why do you have to sit down in guilt that you committed one sin and you run away from church? You committed one sin and you're no more serving God. You committed one sin and you are not. In fact, when you see your church people, you're hiding. Why? Does that mean that you do not understand the scripture that God says here in 2 Peter chapter 3 verse 18? He said, "But grow in the grace." When you have given your life to Christ, knowing God is that you have that personal relationship with God. Some of us, as I was preparing, you know, the Holy Spirit says some of us have a father and we have our mothers. We have our siblings. The Holy Spirit asked me, say, when they ring you on the phone and you see the call and it's your father, how do you feel? I said, I feel happy. And that is what it's supposed to be. That's what it's supposed to be. You need to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. That when you stand up in the morning and say, "Good morning, Jesus. Good morning, Lord. I know you came from heaven above. The Holy Spirit is on the throne. Good morning, Jesus. Good morning." You are happy and you're excited that He is here. He's here with you. He can see you. He has sent His angel down for you. And He's there waiting for you to ask Him for forgiveness. If you have known Christ, why do you live in guilt? I'm not sure why that message keeps coming. Why do you live in guilt of what you have done? The guilt of taking alcohol. When you say you're a Christian, you're hiding to drink. Because of that, you start to run away from God. God is saying to you that you need to grow in this grace and knowledge of God. When you know that God is a merciful God, you go back to Him. And cry to Him and ask for forgiveness of sin and ask Him for the grace for you not to do the same thing again. Knowing God is not growing in the grace of God. You took drugs, you took alcohol, you committed abortion and all that. You run away from church. God says, I should tell you to come back to church. Come back to Him. Come back to where you used to serve God. Go back to God. He's waiting for you there. With that filthiness you think you are, God still wants you to come. It doesn't matter how many times you've messed up. God says, I should tell you to come back to Him. Like the prodigal son, that He's going to receive you. Hallelujah. Knowing God is having the knowledge of God. And also knowing how God speaks to you. I am going to talk on this. Having the knowledge of God, you know who your God is. You know who your biological father is. You know who your biological mother is. And you know when they want, you know when they are angry. And you know how to figure out your way to go back to them. You know what to do to appease them. If you know what to do to appease your earthly parents, how much more can you not appease the God of heaven? Knowing Him is to know when you need to draw near to Him. A lot of times we are so carried away by our works. We are so busy. We don't really have no single time for ourselves. And God is just sitting down from the window of heaven. And the Bible says that God is riding in the cloud for our sake. He's going around for a sec in the cloud. He's running. When you're going here, he's running after you. You go back here, he's chasing after you. Instead of you chasing God, but God is chasing you. Because God cares about you. That's why he said, what is man that you are mindful of them? Oh, it's son of man that you are visiting them. God visits you every day. When you're going north, he's with you. Why is he with you? Because you have made a covenant to serve him. You made a promise to serve him. And your name was removed from the book of death into the book of life. And from that day, you are in the hollow of God's hands. Wherever you go, the presence of God go with you. So when you don't pray, when you don't pray in the morning, when you don't pray in the afternoon, when you don't pray in your heart, you don't need to practically kneel down and begin to pray 10, 20 minutes. Let the Spirit of God dwell in you. And then you'll be communicating with your maker. Even when you are driving your car, you are talking to your God. Even when you're doing your work, you're talking to your God. That is the relationship. You know what I mean? That's what I say, Father, today. I don't want to get into trouble. There are some patients you see, they just come, they are coming. You can see that they are venting, they are venting trouble. As that patient enters the consulting room, you know that, you know what, he is venting trouble. But you know what, I say, God, in my heart, please, whatever is wrong with this patient coming in, Father, arrest him for your daughter's sake. And he will do it. You don't need to practically shaka ba 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 and buy. No. Knowing God is going with God. Hey, God, I don't know how to explain this. When you are driving your car alone, always remember that Jesus is on the passenger seat. He's next to you. Or sometimes you have to say, God, I shift. I make a shift from this steering. You take over. And you find out that Jesus will take over. He will sit inside of you and will direct you because you know him. He directs you the way you steer, the way you go. And just in front of you, there was supposed to be an accident. He has waved you to the right. Some people will say, it's my driving skill. No, it's because you know the Lord and the Lord knows you. Jesus said in John 5, if I'm not mistaken, he said, my sheep know me. Or John 10. My sheep know me. They know my voice and I know them. You need to build relationship with God. There are people that are so much amazed in God that when missiles are coming left and right and center, God is picking the missiles from them. God is removing the missiles from them. Do you know how many times? Do you know how many times missiles are coming from the north, from my father's house, from my mother's house, from friends, from relatives, from classmates? I am not shaken. I am not shaken. Because he that is in me is greater than he that is in the world. Hallelujah. If you know your God, you will not be afraid of what men will do to you. When you're walking on the street, I try to talk to my children. I want them to get to know God. I talk to my siblings. I wanted to get to know God the way God has taken me to. And I'm telling you today, when you know God and have that relationship with God, you're going to be watching your dreams. God speaks to everybody. He can speak to you through dreams. He can speak to you when you're driving. He can speak to you loud in your ear. You have to, if you know your God, your creator, you have to know when he's speaking to you, because it is not fair. You know when your biological earthly fathers, you know, or your siblings, how they speak to you. You have to be able to recognize God. When I was a very young believer, I did not understand. Yeah, I go to church. I was born again. I do everything, you know. But I did not have this relationship with God. I have relationship with God, born again. But I did not get to know God. Know him. I did not really understand what it means to really know God. And when God speaks to me, sometimes I just took it for granted. Imagine that I was planning to get married, and God showed me that I was carrying my wedding gown in ambulance that they carry dead body. That was what I was using to carry my wedding clothes, carry my wedding, my wedding things, which means that my wedding was already dead before it started. But let's thank God for the grace of God. Meaning me, knowing your God is writing your dreams down. Writing it down. and keeping it short. Don't tell people. Let God manifest what he wants to manifest. When I was younger, I gave my life to Christ at very young age of 11, and the Spirit of God was pushing, was so pushing. Well, when I get into university, because of so much of load in medical school, I start to fall away. I didn't fall away out of grace, but my relationship with God was a bit like hiccups, because I pay more attention to medicine, to reading, to studying, but God was still there. God still loves me. He was still there guiding me through it. So I am telling you this morning, that God said you should go back and mend your relationship with him. Return back in place that God said you should be functioning. Go back there. Do not let alcohol, fornication, or anything you have done to make you run away from God, saying that you have messed up. God wants you to come back in that same state that you think you have messed up. God wants you to come back the same way. Today, a lot of people have left church. They have left church because they are gay. They are lesbian. They're homosexual. And the church will stand on the pulpit, condemn them. Jesus never condemned anybody. Knowing your God is seeing yourself that you run away from the presence of God, you get into homosexuality, and then you now know that, oh, that's not the right way, and come to church, and a pastor is there to receive you, to pray for you, to put you on the gospel lane. That is about knowing God. God, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, never condemned anybody. That was why when he caught the woman that was committing adultery, and everybody were out there to stone her, to kill her, but Jesus Christ said, anybody that have never committed sin, write it down here. But today the church of God has turned to the court of Sanhedrin, the court where they judge people before even heaven judged them. I feel so bad when a man of God died in Nigeria. T.B. Joshua. I don't really care who he is. I don't know him. But the Bible says that by his fruit, by their fruit, you shall know them. How many men of God have died in my country, Nigeria, that women, widows, children, everybody are crying? Because he touched lives. If he was not a man of God, let God be his judge. But people that call themselves anointed men of God, the men that people are looking unto, they held malice. They held malice against somebody from when he's alive until he's dead. Where are we heading to? Who made you a judge? Romans 8 says, who made you a judge? For the same way you're judging people, so shall you be judged as well. Yes, it was not a part of Pentecostal Fellowship of Nigeria. So what? Is Pentecostal Fellowship of Nigeria the ticket to heaven? Absolutely no. And people hated him when he was alive, because they are the ones that knew all about T.B. Joshua's sin. They knew everything about him because they are God. They have a book. They mark all his sins. Why don't you leave people judgment for God? They know they are God. You know your God. Everybody, we are running this race. On the final day, let God be our judge. It's time for gay people to come back to church. Lesbian to come back to church. Because the same God that created me and you that created them. We need to bring them back to Christ in love. Knowing God is about forgiving. It's about forgiving one another. Loving people even though they are so sinful and wretched. Loving them the way they are and bringing them to the knowledge of Christ. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Knowing God. Sorry, I'm just trying to. Knowing God is understanding God's grace and growing in the grace every day. When you are faced with temptations and trials, You begin to sing, I have decided to follow Jesus. No turning back. Knowing God is saying that this situation I'm seeing today is just a temporary situation. Because I know my God will come for me. My God will surely come for me. That I'm not married today does not mean that I don't have a man. That doesn't mean that God did not make a man for me, that I'm not married today. That does not mean that I don't have children because God did not put children in my womb. No, but God is going to use me as a testimony. God is going to use me as a testimony. That's why God is delaying me from having children. So God will use my life as a testimony for people that are waiting for the fruit of the womb. That is you knowing God. And also knowing God is about believing in His word. His word, His word is very important. Knowing God is believing in His word, that His word is life and active. I need to read the scripture so that I will back that up on the scripture. Hebrews 4 verse 12. Hebrews 4 verse 12 says, "For the word of God is alive and active." Hey, hallelujah. Knowing God is for you to understand that God's word is alive and active. And knowing God is that going to use you, the word of God, to evaluate your situation. I don't have a job. I don't have money. But what is God saying? You open your scripture, you read. And God says, "That they that wait upon the Lord will renew their strength. They shall mount on their wings like eagles. They will never be weary." That is what God is saying to me. So I am waiting upon the Lord and I will never be wearied. I know that God will surely come for me. For He says that. When you pass, Isaiah 43 says, when you pass through the waters, verse 19 and 20 says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. When you pass through the fire, it will not the fire will not consume you. The flame will not scorch your skin. Therefore, God did not tell you that you're not going to pass through water. So God said God did not tell you you're not going to pass through fire, but God said that you will pass through waters. You pass through waters of unemployment, waters of fruitlessness, water of lack of knowledge. That you're reading your books and you go to exam, you go so blank. Water of you not being able to move from one stage to another, that you're stagnated in one place from years to years. That is the water. But God said that water will not drown you. When God said the water will not drown you, it means that there's a time for the water to toss you to and fro. But the hand of the Lord is coming down to pick you up out of that waters. Fire burns. Situation that we are burns us. Especially when a man wake up in the morning and put his hand in his pocket and cannot see nothing like money for him to buy clothes for his wife, for his children, or to pay the school fees. It burns like fire. But God said to me to tell you that knowing your God is for you to know that when you go through the waters, when you pass through the fire, that He is there. He is watching you and that He will come. He will come at the right time. But knowing your God is for you to tell God, "Father, please come now. Come now." Habakkuk said, "I stand in the window and watch. Stand in your window and watch heaven and cry to God. Say, Father, come now, come now." And He will come. He's a God of miracle. If you listen to Him, if it's a miracle, let me just share this testimony before I round up today. I live in this house and I have two computers. And I've been using the Apple computers because that is the one that I love. But I have a computer that has been over 12 years old and it's here on my table and I don't use it. But I love to use the Apple because I bought the Apple computer during COVID-19. Knowing your God is to listen to him when he speaks to you. And I had a very important professional exam to write on just last week. And I was using my Apple computer and the Holy Spirit came. God said to me, you need to clean your old computer because that's what you're going to use for whatever you're going to do tomorrow. And I called my daughter. I said, get all the papers out of the computer. Get everything out. Give me spray. Give me a cleaner. I start to clean the and dust the computer. I believe that they were so shocked that I'm cleaning the computer that I have abandoned for so many months, for years. And I clean up that computer and I finish. And I turn on the computer and it was working. And in the morning, because I have always been a victim, if I don't listen to what God says, I'm going to be punished for it. In the morning, I went there to do my professional exam. I went on that computer. And it's something that, you know, is something that has a time limit. And when I went on that computer, I started. I have internet. But when I look on the Apple computer, there's no internet. And the whole computer in the house, including my children's phone and every gadget, television, everything, there was no computer. There was no internet. But the only computer that had internet in the house is the one that God said I should clean and use. And then the cable that gives us the broadband cable that gave us internet. There was no internet in that broadband. It was blinking yellow, green. There was no internet. But how did internet come on this computer? It was a miracle that nobody can fathom. Nobody can fathom. Because I know my God and I listen to him. And today I'm asking you, try to pray and listen to your God, your creator. Know him when he's speaking to you. Know him when what he wants you to do. Know him where he wants you to go. Know him when he says you should stop. Know him when he says you should talk. Know him when he says you should not talk. When he says to you, quiet, know when he says quiet. I want to pray for you now. If you are hearing this message and you want to give your life to Christ, there's this opportunity for you to give your life to Christ. And if you have been in the Lord, and for one reason or the other, you have left the church. Or if you've been in the Lord, and for one reason or the other, you have crossed your heart away from God. And you're saying that God is not there. If God was there, I would not be suffering like this. God is calling you back to repentance today. God wants you to come back to him. As you make your way back to God today, by the finger of God upon my life, I'm going to pray. I'm going to ask God to give you a miracle. And when you get that miracle, please come back and testify on this platform. And God bless you. Father, we thank you. Thank you for how far you have led us today. Thank you, Father, for how far you have led us today. Thank you, Jesus, for giving us the word today. Thank you for coming down to speak to us, oh God, the way you want us to know. The way you want us to hear you today. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. For, oh God, we are just a tool in your hand. As you want to use us, Father, you use us. Lord, I pray, God, oh Lord, that the word that has come out of this altar, Father, I pray that it will be, it will make exploits in the life of your children. In the mighty name of Jesus, Father, those that wandered away from you, oh God, because of one thing or the other, and they ran away from faith, oh Lord, because of what people have done to them, or what they have seen, or what they have heard. Lord, King of glory, I pray that you help their eyes to be fixed unto you. Because you say we should look unto you, the author and finisher of our faith. Well, help them to come back to you and give their life back to you in the name of Jesus Christ. For those of us that have given our life to Christ, Father, I pray in all the waters, in all the fires that we are going through. Father, Lord, we know. Because you are there, you are watching us from the windows of heaven. You know our strengths, you know our weaknesses, Lord. We are praying, oh God, that you will come, oh God. You will change our sadness into testimony. You change our sadness into testimonies, Lord. In the name of Jesus. Whatever we are waiting for you, oh God. Father, whatever I've been mocking us for so many years, and we are waiting upon you, oh God. Father, Lord, you said that they that wait upon you, you renew their strength. Father, renew our strength. We will not fall, we will not falter. We will not fail you, we will not disappoint you. My Lord and my God, I pray, oh Lord, that you will help us. You will answer our prayers, oh Lord. Every prayer we have been praying and waiting on you, Father, give us a miracle. Well, your name is a miracle working God. You never fail, you never change. In times and in seasons, you are the same. You say, call unto me in the days of your trouble and I will answer you. I will show you great and mighty things, Lord. Father, show your children great and mighty works, oh Lord. In the name of Jesus, Father, I pray. Every disease is in their body, every sickness in their body, anything that is stopping them from serving you, Lord, I pray in the name of Jesus. I stretch out my hands to God and I pray for everyone to receive healing in the name of God the Father, in the name of God the Son, in the name of God the Holy Spirit, in the name of Jesus. Father, I pray that you open our ears, Father, so that we can hear you. Open our ears so that we can hear you. Circumcise our heart to God, that we can walk with you, we can communicate with you, we can build a relationship with you in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. For in Jesus' mighty name I pray. Amen. God bless you.